Hi, my name is Timur. So you've already, I think, all been there. Someone shows you this really weird snippet of really weird C++ code and tells you, did you know this is valid C++? And you're like, what? And you're like, oh, okay. But yeah, no one's gonna write code like that anyway, right? And then you go off and have a nice day. But you can't do that if you maintain a C++ parser. If you do that, then you have to like, oh, okay, sit down with the standard and figure out whether it's actually valid code. And if it is, and it doesn't work, fix the bug. So what you end up doing a lot is staring at the C++ grammar. C++ has a grammar. It's about 20 pages in the standard that looks like this. There's beautiful things in there, like a pseudo-destructor name, liberated type specifier, or the no-decal function declaration, which is, of course, a function declaration with no decal specifier sec. This grammar is just an aid to comprehension. It's not an exact statement of the language. And in particular, all these really complicated rules must be used to read out syntactically valid but meaningless constructs. But it turns out, even if you do all that, then there's still a lot of weed growing. For example, linkage specifiers, this kind of X and C kind of thing. Grammar for that is the linkage specification is the declaration, and it can also contain the declaration with braces, without braces. So it actually nests, right? So it can nest with braces, it can also nest without braces. And actually, extend has a second meaning. Extend can also be a storage specifier, right? Which is also part of the declaration. So we can put it, well, where do you put it? In the beginning or in the end? Well, which one is correct? Godbolt's not gonna help you because Microsoft rejects the first, GCC rejects the second, and Clang thinks both are okay. Great C++ 17 feature, if with initializer. The initializer is the thing before the semicolon. It's great to initialize a variable. Here's the grammar for it. It turns out init statement, that's the thing that we're talking about here, can be either a declaration or an expression. Basically, it means it can be pretty much anything. So you can forward declare a class in there, that's valid. You can put an expression in there like false, that's valid C++. You can actually put an empty expression in there as well, that's also perfectly valid C++ grammar. I find a lot of compiler bugs when I was looking at these things. Great topic, initialization. We already saw a talk on initialization this week. There's about 50 ways you can initialize an int. This is just four of them. The best one, of course, is the one with parentheses, because it's so great that parentheses, they appear everywhere and they conflict with everything. So that's definitely my favorite one. Let's, for example, take a function pointer, which also has lots of parentheses. This is, of course, not modern C++. We have to write a trailing return type. That's much better. And because the function pointer is variable, you can initialize it. You can put the initializer in parens. That's great. Most parsers will just say no, but it's valid. You can also put parens around declarators, like variable names, right? Which is great because, for example, you have a function that takes a foo, which is a struct. Let's give this parameter a name. Let's also call it foo, just because we can. Let's put parens around the declarator. Now, we all know this is the vexing pass. Now it's a different thing, right? It's actually a function, taking a foo, returning void. Great, that's the vexing pass. But actually, this is not the most vexing pass. There's a more vexing pass, which happens if you put another pair of parentheses around the thing. So what type is this? Anyone knows? Different compilers, again, give you very different answers. Right, next thing, elaborate type specifier. That's really great. So it's used here if you have like bar and it's an int and it's also a class, then you can't declare a bar like that. You have to kind of disambiguate it. But it turns out that actually you can just use it like, it's optional, but you can just use it. It actually turns out the grammar says you can use it everywhere. You can use a normal type specifier. So if you have something like this, you can sprinkle the whole thing with elaborated type specifiers. It's great. You can actually automate this. You can write a script that adds an elaborated type specifier everywhere where grammatically it's valid. It's great because every parser will just blow up. It's fun. They're also great because they're also, elaborated type specifier also can simultaneously act as a forward declaration, right? So this takes a pointer to S and also automatically forward declares S. So that is actually going to compile even if S is not declared anywhere. And actually it's great because it also has really weird scoping rules, like if you put that in a class, it's still going to be visible outside. Yeah, great feature. I love C++. Pseudo-destructor name, that's another one which is really great. So pseudo-destructor name is tilde with a type name, so it looks like a destructor, but actually the actual destructor would be tilde class name. Class name and type name are different things. So type name would be a type which is not a class in this case. So you can do something like this, except actually you can't because int is actually not a type name. Int is a type specifier, so you have to use a using, and then it's okay. But fear not, fear not. So the destructor for int doesn't work. Let's declare one. That compiles. Unfortunately, this is of course not a destructor. This is a default constructor int, which is a zero, and then bit not, right? So this tilde thing is really ambiguous, right? Like it's like it could be one or the other. So I have a suggestion how to you know, make it better so that you never confuse destructors with these kind of things. So if you have a class and you know, we declare a constructor and a destructor and this tilde thing, and we really want to make sure that's not the bit not tilde, we can actually write it like that. Because we have alternative tokens. Right? So the alternative token for tilde is compil, which is great. So now this doesn't look like an expression anymore. So it's nice and clean. And actually, this doesn't work only for destructors. It also works for copy constructors and move constructors. You can also use alternative tokens for those. This is also valid C++. So I recommend that we declare our special member functions like this because it looks much cleaner. You know, it's much simpler to English, much more like English, you know. This is what we want our code to look like English, not like gibberish, right? So, yeah, great. That's all I have. Thank you.